Legal Services Director at KIAC. He puts in 12-hour days volunteering at that little nonprofit, just the way his wife puts in 12-hour days as our county commissioner. What does Ray do? Ray stands up for some people who are under attack these days, people who are targeted, people whom we are told because they are up in the woods of Mason County picking brush or in a restaurant washing dishes have somehow stolen people's jobs and futures and greatness. Ray helps those who want to work to find a legal route to stay here and keep doing their jobs. Standing up for people who are political targets can make you a target, can make Ray a target. Unless we all stand together, where it says in number one of our 7 UU principles, unless we stand together shoulder to shoulder for the inherent worth and dignity of every person. Ray Garrido.
One little note about the wife that works 12-hour days. She's the one that brought the book just now because I forgot it when I left this morning. So, just before I begin, the song that we just heard reminded me of some peace work that friends and I did in Belfast years ago. And so I want to begin by wishing you all peace. The current environment towards immigrants has parallels in history. Think about the Japanese internment. Think about the German ship St. Louis with 900 Jews fleeing Nazi Germany who were turned back by the United States government. KIAC reaches out to immigrants from all countries, both documented and undocumented. Welcoming the stranger is intrinsic to many faith traditions and philosophies, and is the basis for hospitality in homes and countries around the world. KIAC shares with the Unitarians the goal of a world community with peace, liberty, and justice for all. I am glad to be here today to talk about our common purpose and how we respond to current challenges on that purpose. KIAC Immigration Legal Services serves people from forks to Shelton. Our long-term mission is integration of our community, but our short-term mission is keeping families together and protecting this vulnerable population from the aggressive enforcement activities of the current administration. And I just want to acknowledge three of our volunteers who have come today, Juan Antonio, Jan Johnson, and Keith Johnson, who dedicate a lot of time to our organization helping people who need our help. Thank you. The administration says it is targeting criminals. The reality is it is targeting all immigrants. During the first 100 days of this year, agents from ICE in Seattle arrested 1,070 people in Washington, Oregon, and Alaska, a 33% increase over the same period last year. The number of people arrested with no criminal history rose by 360%. The next step after arrest is being held in a private detention center, like the Northwest Detention Center in Tacoma, and placed in removal proceedings. And in many cases, that means deportation. These detention centers are privately owned by for-profit corporations who earn billions of dollars from immigrant sorrow. The government guarantees these corporations that a minimum number of beds will be filled every day. They employ inmates at minuscule wage rates to perform in the detention centers. The conditions in many of them are abominable. In fact, detainees at the Northwest Detention Center in Tacoma go on hunger strikes to protest their conditions regularly. Since January 8th, 8 people have died in detention centers across the United States. Some facilities have their own phone systems, which the inmates are required to use at exorbitant rates, and it is their only way of communicating with their families other than limited visitation. It is our taxpayer dollars that finance detention centers and ICE activities. In contrast, the work of the Citizenship and Immigration Services, whom we work closely with, is financed by fees. In the 14th century, medieval communities built walls around their towns to protect them. That's a 14th century approach, not a 21st century approach. It isn't the approach of the United States that I know. In 1990, the Berlin Wall was torn down. It was a long-hated symbol of tyranny, oppression, and division. A barrier now divides Israel and Palestine, and again, a symbol of division and long-standing strife and distrust. What does a wall on our southern border tell the world about the United States? We are a country that has benefited from opening our arms to the world, not building walls around ourselves. Our history is full of stories of people who came here seeking refuge and who made our country a better place. What do we say to the girl fleeing abject poverty and abuse when she's detained and put in removal proceedings aimed at sending her back to her abusers? What do we say to the grandmother who built a life here over the past 20 years when ICE takes her from her home and starts to deport her? And how do we explain this to the children and grandchildren she leaves behind? What do we say to the boy who fled the gang that repeatedly told him they would kill him and his family if he didn't join, and who our government is now trying to send back to that danger? What has happened to the compassion in this country that is trying to send them away? These actions are against the inherent dignity and worth of immigrant people, and contrary to the common affirmation of Unitarians and Kayak and people all over our country for justice, equity, and compassion in human relations. In addition to targeting our sisters and brothers, the Department of Homeland Security is now targeting organizations like ours by issuing cease and desist orders aimed at stopping us from aiding people who are in removal proceedings and who need our help. The short statements that I read to you earlier about people we work for every day. Each of them is vulnerable, and without the legal services we provide, the probability of them being deported is high. It is widely known that people who go before an immigration judge without representation are 5 times more likely to be deported than those who have representation. And people in removal proceedings don't get assigned legal representatives. They either have to hire an attorney, which many of them cannot afford, or find a pro bono representative, which is very scarce. As a result, even children sometimes have no choice but to represent themselves before an immigration judge. And then there are millions who have not been caught yet, living in fear that's been heightened exponentially by this new administration. Just this past Thursday, we learned of a study in 7 southern states. They screened 2,700 undocumented immigrants and found that over 15% of them may have been qualified for legal status. They also found dozens who were probably U.S. citizens. So the administration will also be deporting U.S. citizens and people who could have stayed here legally. This is what drives us. What is being done to the immigrants in our country is unforgivable, and we will not stand idly by. We're inspired by the truth of Dr. King's observation that the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice. With this inspiration, our work evolves. Since starting our program in 2014, the majority of our work has been helping people who qualify to apply for some legal immigration benefit. Citizenship, a green card, the DACA program, benefits for victims of crimes. Because of this great need of people who are unrepresented, we are now expanding our work to represent people who are in removal proceedings and in danger of being deported, and who desperately need legal representation. Many of them are children who fled horrible conditions in their home countries and suffered long and dangerous trips to the United States, only to have us tell them, "We're going to send you back." Without our help, they will be forced to represent themselves in front of an immigration judge and against a government attorney, even the 9-year-olds. We're expanding our program to include an office in Port Townsend that will enable us to better serve people on the Olympic Peninsula. We have 3 accredited legal representatives working for clients now. Our goal is to have 9 serving them by the end of the year. We have over 450 open cases, and none of them at this point are removal cases. We expect a large amount of them to be coming to us in the next few months. We have 1 paid staff member, Larry O. Webb, who helps keep us together. The rest of us are volunteers. 25 in all contribute over 700 hours a month to our work. I began today with a litany of people in desperate need of our help. I want to close with a very brief list of hopeful outcomes that show what is possible through this work. He was abandoned by his parents and made the dangerous journey to our border, only to be put in removal proceedings. We got him special immigrant juvenile status and then a green card. He's now living with his new family and looking forward to becoming a citizen. She came to us a victim of neglect and abuse. Now she has legal working papers and is on her way to getting a green card. He was brutally beaten by the gangs. We helped him to get his green card, and later proudly. Watched him take his citizenship over. Now he's applying to bring his wife and children to the United States. In recent months, caring communities like yours have spoken out against the injustice and have provided us with support and fellowship that helps us continue our work. While the fear is great among our sisters and brothers, they are also grateful for our help and hopeful for the future. The tyranny of this administration will not last forever. While it does, we will stand against it and use every resource we have to make sure that justice prevails. When it has passed, we look forward to a country where the value of each of us is treasured and where justice and fellowship bind us together.